Welcome everybody here to your grand final of the Gigabyte Challenge. I'm your host for the English live stream and our finals day today. Wow, that was a little bit flamboyant. I am W1. I'll be being you, game number one, and then game number two, and potentially game number three. This is a best of three grand final. 1,500 euro goes to first place, while 500 will go to the second position, courtesy of these wonderful guys at Gigabyte. Of course, you can spam them up, love their kind of stuff, and also buy their stuff as well. Because that's what they want. That's the reason why these tournaments happen. We let you guys know, we give the public something to play for, and Gigabyte, the wonderful people that support it. So, shout out to them. Awesome. Into the game. Into the game we go. Aftershock! They are the team to qualify themselves through the lower part of the, the bracket, and then the upper part of the bracket, which doesn't actually mean there was a double elimination, still a single elim. Just they came from the upper part and the lower part to find themselves here in the grand final. So, Moscow 5, they had themselves a bit of a bloodbath in the last game. We had going at almost 2 kills a minute just for them.
Radiant team ban.
So they're on a bit of a run right now. That was with Blow Your Brain's core vengeful spirit just pushing the envelope here and there. Bans out from Moscow 5, Brewmaster, as well as the Faceless Voice. We're back to a little bit more of a setup ban coming out from PGG.
10 seconds remaining.
While Kefka has taken out the Razor as well as the Batrider. Wisp also coming into the band pool there. No buff up combinations for them on that front. Reserve while the Okamajai and Tidehunter are the pickups from Moscow 5. So again, the Tidehunter, he was really successful in the last game, but they did give him a lot of space for it. The ability just to run that Tidehunter on a safe lane got him some really quick experience going one-on-one with Nature's Prophet. And we'll see if he gets as lucky this time around. Just taking out the heroes, which make that very difficult to do. If I was Aftershock, I'd look towards Bingo, that guy right there. Brilliant. Any hero which basically makes the aggro tri-lane work. That's where there'll be some problems coming up. The Death Prophet, more than likely PTG will just pick a hero, any kind of hero that works nicely up against her, and then synergize her with their aggressive moving lineup later on.
10 seconds remaining. Five seconds.
So Moscow 5 final ban out. We're going to get the Centaur. The only other hero which might be then Bristleback wouldn't present too much of a problem until he started getting a little bit more farm up, and then you can just rotate some other heroes in. Nature's Prophet, they have no problem letting that one through, even with the Death Prophet, like the double prophets together. It won't be enough pushing power to really give them cause to worry. They just ban out the Visage instead. So a hero which could actually cause a lot of problems with arrows, as well as obviously Nightmare switching. So more than likely it'll be a Bane as the fourth hero pickup, and Aftershock have a choice right now. They could potentially block pick it, but it'll make their lane way too passive. Way too passive if they do that. So, more than likely, I will assume it'll just be a Bane pickup here by PGG in the fourth slot, and he'll keep his last slot very much open, as if he, like, where he wants to switch it. And they could even switch up their lanes if they wanted to, and run like a Morana Bane in the mid, put an Okamajai with a Tide in the bottom, and then just pick up a different offlane hero. So the choices are very, very open as far as the lineup goes. I'm liking the way PGG has approached tonight. He must have been drinking tonight, because he always drafts better when he drinks. Love the big man. Love the big man. He'll always be my happy little Santa from TI. He's such a happy guy. You're such a happy guy. Alright, Aftershock. You're going up against an aggro tri-lane. Assume that. Which means they have to draft to be up against that. And the Abaddon will be the selection here.
Radiant team pick.
A little bit too passive in the lane is my concern. That's my primary concern right now. It's just going to be too passive in the lane. Even if, like, they could in fact now do exactly what I was talking about, where you just switch the lanes up and start running dual lanes. They actually run a Nature's Prophet of their own.
Dire team pick.
Here, which PGG likes to play a hell of a lot of. If he's playing support role, though, he won't be playing this. It'll go into the hands of somebody else. I don't know if Tra-Ta-Ta, Blade Brain, or, in fact, Tron like to play that hero. They could actually just run a support Nature's Prophet. Because they're just so passive in their lanes, Aftershock. The Abaddon and Rubick are really great, like, control heroes, but
10 seconds,
like, there's
remaining.
No, like, you get some burst damage coming out from them, sure.
Radiant team back.
But once they get controlled by, like, an Ogre Stun, they won't be able to protect themselves from the Tidehunter Ravage. They're not those kind of heroes. And they don't really enable heroes to go over aggressive on other heroes either. Like the Rubik telekinesis is a nice thing, like Abaddon shielding. I guess, suppose yes. In that regard, yes, Abaddon can keep people alive. The point I'm trying to get to is like they can't make it so you can jump in for those kills. They have no jump in heroes. Like a Rubik, if you can steal leap, then maybe. If you can afford a blink dagger, then maybe. But the rest of it is kind of like Aftershock saying, we're here, you come at us, and then we counter initiate. If you do that up against Nature's Prophet, he'll split push the crap out of you. And also, diving into, like, up the high ground, up against an Okamishai, it only takes one good multicast, and the fight turns. And you have a Tidehunter on top of that. Yeah. I'm interested to see how they approach this. The Viper is going to be banned out. So they're actually assuming that Mirana is going to be a support Mirana. And that's actually a wise decision as well. PGG has played a lot of support Mirana. And the last hero choice now from Moscow 5. Do they try and actually run Luna. Something like a Bane? Nope, they go for the Luna.
Dire team pick.
And they'll allow themselves to force out their bottom lane when they're ready. Okamishai and Mirana or the walking combo. And that means Aftershock needs some good counter push. They've already technically got it with a Death Prophet Crypt Swarm. So whatever lane she's in, it'll be okay. Rubik with the Fade Bolt's also quite good at defense. Timbersaw can't need to shark him before he's really ready to defend.
10 seconds remaining.
And he's going to be worried about that chip damage coming out too between the Ogre and Swell, as well as the Luna.
5 seconds remaining.
Loosen Beam, Ignite, Stuns, into Mirana, potential long-range arrows
Reserve
too.
Time.
Easy kills, Nature's Prophet. Going to look to find a lot of early experience. So because it's a Rubik and an Abaddon, he's not going to feel too pressured on the lane. In fact, more than likely, the Rubik's going to lose more life than the Nature's Prophet will. And Abaddon's going to be feeding it over to him the entire time. So, Aftershock.
Slark.
They go for a Slark. Momentum Boy. A hero who's also really good at catching out Nature's Prophets on their lane. And that's a nice hero selection at the last point. I'm still concerned, though, that the amount of damage output is going to be too much for Aftershock to handle. But at the same time, it shouldn't be too hard. Like, both teams definitely have some really good merits. The pushing power, the tank ability from Aftershock is really good. The survivability is really great from them. The early ability to force the issue from Moscow 5 is really, really good too. And their ability to push down lanes and just have a really good fight is also quite good. Their initiation is probably better. Their split push would be questionably better. The Nature's Prophet doesn't really have a lot of space now that the Slark is on the field.
5 seconds.
Because the Slark on the field is able to run across the map very, very quickly. So it's not one of those, oh, well, I can just TP myself out to wherever the hell I want to, especially if that Slark picks up a Blink Dagger. Obviously, it's still some better level of control on Nature's Prophet because he'll just TP himself away to safety if you don't have a stun. That is actually probably something else we should flag. Where are the stuns coming out from Aftershock? At this point, they have a Leash and Telekinesis. Their control abilities are quite low. You get a BKB, then all of that magical damage which A-Shock are trying to pump out doesn't really exist. Obviously, Death Prophet is still going to have a large amount of physical DPS. But that is all. While Moscow 5 have Sprouts, Lucent Beams, Ravagers, Fire Blasts, Arrows, Longer Arrows, all these things put together make for just a really, really strong lineup. So for now, we look towards our lanes and say Blow Your Brain. Ring of Aquila is going to be his build of choice over on this Luna. He'll have the support of PGG's Mirana. It will put Tron back onto that Tidehunter again. That puts King R. He'll be as the Ogre Magi. And that leaves our last one, which is Tratata. Will be the Nature's Prophet. Final hero. They're going to drop a Sentry Ward just to block up this camp. And Rubik's very much aware of that. He's already got his own Sentry Ward. Actually, I'm not as sure about this. The Observer Ward's meant to help him. Okay, Slark. Just seeing the three of them hiding on the tree line. Yeah, because if you drop a Sentry Ward here and then the Sentry Ward gets dewatered, then you drop your Sentry Ward, then you drop your Observer, and you still get the block. You have to go through, like, two sentries for it, though, which is, like, the downside. But it definitely means that this Rubik will be pulling. Not as an aggressive observer warp. The ping's coming out just saying that they know Abaddon's up there.
The battle begins.
It's Tide versus Timber. And Timber will win that fight hands down. Like, so easily hands down. It's the downside about running a hero like a Tidehunter up against, like, Whirling Death kind of man. But that means he did actually build into Whirling Death. He doesn't have a lot of mana to play around with on that front. Yogamajai has the Invis rune. He's looking for a kill on Mind Control. The early non-Talisman's not going to make that easy. Not to mention the fact they're running an Aegis Prophet in this middle lane. Doesn't make it as easy. In fact, they can say just switch blow your brain towards the top. An offlane Luna who doesn't have any help right now, but the gank in mid. Arrows will come in. Perfect connection on Mind Control. PGG saw it perfectly. And tra-ta-ta will get himself a kill in the middle lane. And that means very early boots if he wants it. Death Prophet will come back to the lane. But already now one level behind that Nature's Prophet. And the supports are already rotating up towards the top two. Ergamajai as well as Mirana. They need to stay with that Luna. While on bottom lane, they kind of need to also get down here and help out the Tidehunter. Swirling Death does not make his life any easier. The upside is the fact that the Timbersaw is about to actually run out of mana. After one more Whirling Death. The downside is, with one more Whirling Death, the Tidehunter could actually find himself running out of life points. Oh, they're going top. Just the Slark pouncing in. The arrow already been thrown. And the shield gives Slark all the protection he really requires here. But the chip damage is also not as easy to fight against. Because the Mirana's got the bonus damage. Tidehunter. Is there a chain? There's no level in it. Back up and you'll pop the salve now. And the Timber is... Well, he's going to have mana shortly for one more Whirling Death. We're looking for another arrow. Okay, well off target from PGG. Not waiting for the setup stun.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
That's a nice thing for a Titan to have now. Level 3 has arrived. Be a lot happier about this. Now he's going for the extra point up in anchor smash, or is he saving it? Yeah, he goes the extra point up in anchor.
Catch us if you can.
This will allow him to, not stay as close. But at least he can be a little bit more of a presence in the lane. PGG rotating in with PGG and another PGG. He has Naro available, but he's kind of waiting for a better target to connect into. Didn't hit the arrow before, and that Hellfire Blast wasn't really enough. Death Prophet killing himself to a neutral. I'm assuming that's just a quicker way back to base. Spent the money, has a TP scroll. Yeah, just a quicker way back to base. After picking up the bounty rune at the bottom river. Still not the most efficient way as far as like losing out in that mid. Arrow well off target again from PGG. The Ignite connects over on the Slark and that will continuously tick him down, but he's also got Salve as well as 5 stick charges available. They pick up Blow Your Brain. He's got another Lucid Beam available. They've got enough damage into the Slark, they do. PGG had enough, he's gonna leap. The Feybolt bouncing around the Abaddon. He cannot let the shield proc next to him, because if it does, then he's gonna die. Is it enough? It's only level 1 shield. Maybe it won't be enough. No, PGG will just run himself away. He's got mana for an arrow in a moment. Oh, Feybolt. It's available. He'll have to telekinesis though. A pickup, a throwback, Prophet teeping himself in the Sprout. It locks the Abaddon on the hill. The Ignite will kick in as well. He does have an ability to deny himself, and I think that's exactly what he's turning to try and do. But he couldn't do it at the end of the day. Ergamajai will take the kill. Yeah, a little bit of rotation up from Mind Control, but it's a level 4.5 Death Prophet. More supports coming in too. One last Sprout, can't get it off in time. Now the leash onto Ergamajai. Quick stun with Elusive Beam. Arrow comes in from PGG, but misses on both Slark and Rubick as they were able just to dodge it. It's a lot of rotation and commitment from both teams, but I don't think anyone really could say came out on top of that one. Too many heroes lost in Moscow 5 most definitely. The change kicks in for Aftershock. And that mid solo died after he got a nice little start in that mid. But the fact that Blow Your Brain didn't go down is what makes me just question who really got the upper hand in that. On the bottom lane, the Tidehunter is ahead of the Timbersaw. Timbersaw's still not at a point where he has enough like burst damage that he can actually contest him. Stuns. It's a leap away. That Slark is really difficult to kill.
Come.
Ty's about to crack level 6. So they're going to add Ravage to the mix now. And that may just be enough to catch Timber out of position, because again, this Timber. Like, not a single point up in temperature. He put everything into Whirling Death. Now the Sharkram, and he might get his advantage for it. Then again, he's out of mana. He can't chase any further. Top lane's getting into position to go again. Every time PGG walks off that side in the minimap, I have to keep my eyes up on this top lane. They're looking for the stun, but they do not want the Slark. The Slark is not the way they get kills here on the top lane. They need the supports down first. And then they just force the issue. Chip damage is the only way they can really kill off the Slark. They catch him when he's low before he can go to a Shadow Dance. Now the arrow flies up again from PGG. Off target. Blow Your Brain being picked up, leashed up, Fade Bolted as well. He doesn't have even time to get one last Lucent Beam off. And with also that Wrath of Nature popping through from the Prophet, he'll TP in. They get the stun, the Sprout. Slark, 4 seconds left. They did actually throw the Ignite over on the Slark, but the arrow this time from PGG will be able to connect. He's taking a lot of damage. The Fade Bolt from the Rubick will get the kill. The attack, the 6 charges, keep him alive. One last Fire Blast to get the kill. Then the Sprout into the Rubick. He'll TP himself out. No stun available. He's away to safety. They'll have to creep skip and try and take out this top tower. At the same time, they must find some space for this, like... The Luna needs more space to farm, really. Now you bring down the tier 1 tower in the top lane, that's fantastic. But they got nowhere to follow into the tier 2 tower. She can't go to the bottom lane because the Tempestor will kill her off. A lot of problems facing this lineup of Moscow 5.
Dire's structures are fortified.
This isn't like the momentum they got on their lineup last time. But they're already bailing out, but the tower, just before it hits to anywhere near deny range, get themselves back into their lanes, tied back up against that Timbersaw. They put Mirana in the middle lane for the moment, but Nature's Prophet does return. The arrow trying to search for mind control. PGG, he's really had a bad hit percentage rate on the arrows tonight. He's definitely just fishing too. Some of them not so much of a fish. Like, most of the fish were in the barrel, as opposed to that middle lane arrow, which is a little bit more of an ocean. So many heroes, and Abaddon now scouts him out too. Now he knows what's going on. And they're going to get on this bottom lane. Finally, there's a Timber Chain available. Arcane Boots and, need more regeneration on this Tidehunter. He's the man that's meant to be building into the mech for his team. Blow Your Brain tries to find whatever farm he can up on that top. Not the greatest in the world right now. 18-2. 7.5 minutes in. But respect now being given as well by the Tidehunter to the Timbersaw. He knows he can die so easily to this. And he actually purchases a bottle of all things. Well, the Courier's only just getting back to base now, so it's going to be a while before he can have that back on the lane. The Star Observer Ward is watching perfectly. Which one actually went down first? They're only 4 seconds between each other. The Radiant was born first, so twin wards. So they should have already realized what the hell was going on. Top lane, Blow Your Brain being dragged back again, the leash. And they put a latch on Blow Your Brain, which is what allows them to move back into the safety world.
Dire's bottom tower is under
attack. Have a crack now at the Tidehunter. Support is coming in.
Radiant's
Death Prophet wants more than the Tidehunter, though.
Attack.
She wants to trigger Exorcism and take this tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. That's why they're bringing more support down here too. They'll be ready for the fight. Shows itself quite obviously. Not a lot of mana here though. Like, it's enough for an Exorcism, but not enough for a Crypt Swarm as well. You know, Arcane Brutes in 14 seconds time and that'll be nice, but... This Death Prophet is really not fully ready to fight.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
The fortification will waste a little bit of time. Ogre Magi as well as Tide most definitely are. They need aggressive TPs in, and then Ravage just to hold them. So there goes your Ravage, catches out the Abaddon as well. The arrow connects on the Timbersaw. Support comes in for Nature's Prophet by both himself as well as his ultimate. But the Sharkram with a pullout is too much damage with the ultimate from Death Prophet. It's going to be a 1-for-3 trade off, a double kill for Mind Control. It wasn't a bad initiation from Moscow 5, but they didn't kill the Timbersaw off during its disabled time. And that's what gave them the freedom just to come back out and start shredding apart the Moscow 5 heroes. So 1-0-1 now on the Timbersaw. I thought he did more damage just then. Must have just been a lot more of the Death Prophet ulti. A 3-2-2. With now drums also being completed. Quite literally 3-2-2. But trying to force the issue on this Nature's Prophet. PGG back towards that mid lane and try and find some extra levels. Anything he can get right now. Gets himself at least level 5. But the Rubick and the Abaddon are trying to do exactly the same kind of thing. Regeneration rune can be stolen here by Nature's Prophet. Puts the Sprat down, so he's going to keep mind control in position. He's holding on to that regen, save for a rainy day, probably also when Wrath of Nature comes back off cooldown. They can just trigger it and keep these lanes pressured. Speaking of pressure, there's none currently over on the Slark. Just free farming up this top lane. There's going to bite him in the arse, Moscow 5, if they don't do something about it. They've already lost control of this game. And they need to do something big to get it back again. If they don't, they're going to find themselves down and out, down in the first game. They're trying to give it now to Luna on this bottom lane. A little bit more space. Just let her farm up. Let her be ready for the next team fight. Rely on the Arrows. Rely on the Ogre Magi multicast. But even then, that means they need to get some levels on him. And so far, he's only at level 5. Luna dropping half life. Full Eclipse being triggered as well. Expecting the Timbersaw to dive a little bit more than that. So, Bully your brain getting a little bit itchy on the trigger finger. And here they go again. Exorcism trigger to the T1 tower in the middle lane. Stays numbered. The arrows are flying out again. This time, really good sun over on the Rubick. With the Ignite, the Wrath of Nature, they've got kill. And Death Prophet might feel like this ulti's being wasted a little bit too much. And the Tide comes in with a Ravage available. And Death Prophet with no ultimate. Well, they're not going to force any more issues here. Because they brought the entire of Moscow 5 far from Blow Your Brain into that middle lane. To get one kill on a Rubick because the arrow connected. And even then that was difficult because of the Abaddon. Both teams are being very cautious about that top lane. Slark just keeping himself backed up. He's not being watched by any Observer Ward. So he's going to come back in. And rightly so, he's got Shadow Dance. Like, he shouldn't be really scared of anything Moscow 5 throwing him apart from a 5-second arrow. And most of the time, if you're aware enough, you're going to get your dive packed up before that point.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
It's not that much of a problem for the Slark. His ulti's only a 60-second cooldown. It's at all levels as well, 60 seconds. Bottom lane. Ogre Magi. Well, Rubick and Ogre Magi can see each other. Well, no, they can't. Now they can. Walk over. First stun. PGG. Follow-up arrow. But that stun from Fire Blast is not enough. Let's get to multicast. And now, Leap Away, Moonlight Shadow, also going to be triggered. And this will allow the Ogre Magi to retreat. Sentry wards, detection,
Radiant's
nothing.
Tower has fallen.
Death Prophet, in the meantime, is taking out that tier 1 tower in mid without actually having to use Exorcism.
And after, them.
After this effort in vain to try and find a kill in the bottom lane by Moscow 5. Just trying to get this denial up in time. Arrow. Wow, that's big. A big steal from the Rubick. And this will allow them to also get the last hit in the tower, so even more money coming their way. While in middle lane, they do lose the Death Prophet.
Clearly not your best.
So it comes at a cost. But the death of the Death Prophet is fine for the fact they just stopped a tower from being denied, and they got themselves a kill to boot. So the gold advantage, the experience advantage comes up for Moscow 5 here, because they got a kill on the Death Prophet compared to Ogre Magi. But the gold chain is actually a lot higher for Aisha.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Gonna come in to defend that T1 tower too. It's not gonna be easy to hold the line on these towers. Primarily because Prophet's always gonna start chipping away, and when Luna has high levels, it'll also be easy to be at picks.
Spoil that shot.
So just bring in a lot of damage, bonus damage with her. And then of course the bouncing glaives.
A tribute.
It's a big,
house.
Big momentum builder. Timber's running low on mana. Be a little careful about getting caught out like this. Ogre Magi only needs just one stun. Prophet's going to TP in. The Sprout will be able to hold it. Oh, what a loosened beam. That's almost a kill right there until the 5-second arrow. The Eclipse, yes, thing gets stolen. Now, this Rubick is getting everything he wants.
He's
his own personal Santa. The T1 town's going to go down the top lane, but he's just managed to pick up a full wand, full set of wards. Has his arcane boots, 14 minutes in. And he just stole Eclipse from the Luna. So if anyone tries to jump on him, he'll just trigger it out. It's not the greatest thing in the world, like, as far as, like, the strength of it. But his arrows were 100% on point. He's hit more arrows than PGG has in this game. Nature's Prophet's going, advancing Midas on this mid Prophet. Already up at level 11, having 2,500 gold. Looking nice for that, but we just got a Bloodstone over on the Timbersaw, who's just itching to get himself into kills now. So TP in towards middle lane, and they could just smoke up. In fact, you've already got the smoke coming out from the Abaddon. It's bottom lane as well. It's kind of where they want to try and find the fight. They're going to come up. Slark smoke broke. They know exactly where Tri-Tartar is, and then a quick blink in. Able to get the leash, and Nature's Prophet will go down. He's actually building a Shadow Blade. Very unconventional for a Nature's Prophet. But also very effective in this game, when you think about it. There's a lot of heroes that most definitely need to see him to attack him. There's very few of them that want to be spending the money on dust and a whole bunch of sentry wards across the map. They kind of already had to do it, like, buy a gem at one point anyway because of the Mirana. The Moonlight Shadow was going to cause them problems. Warding. Always a dangerous game. No Yule Scepter fully over on the Death Prophet just yet, now just short of the Void Stone. In 18 seconds time, they do have the ulti from the Death Prophet, so they can just start on Roshan. And if they need to, then they'll bring her ulti up. They're gonna need to. The top tier 1 tower drops. So, full Shadow Blade for a Nature's Prophet. Still a very unusual item. It's primarily just the amount of time you've got with the Shadow Blade, the cooldown time. Oh, nice Sprout. Really nice Sprout. That's gonna give him the Wrath of Nature bounce inside the pit too. The Sharkram is cleaning up the tree line. Well, Roshan's almost dead. The Collapse not making it easy. They still haven't finished the job. Now the Eclipse from the Rubick. He's almost got the kill on the Tidehunter. Steals the Anchor Smash. The Aegis Immortal snatch. Roshan, he was killed by Nature's Prophet. So he takes the golden experience and then goes in the Shadow Blade. They'll trigger off the dust. They can see him. But now the Eclipse comes out from the real Luna. But doesn't do any damage whatsoever. In fact, no one's died just yet until the Rubick. Poor little Mirana getting herself caught on top of the high ground. Got one attack into the courier. Mind control, first stun, breaks him free. Tide Ravage connects on three. Let the bouncing glaives go. The arrow connects on mind control. They need to bring down the Timbersaw though. He's their primary source of damage. A multicast damage again. Maybe it's can all come down the Okamajai. Into the tree, into the pit. Out of vision. Is able to TP himself away to safety. That's just brilliant play by Moscow 5. The fact that Tri-Tartar was able to pick up the last hit too. Like, that's even bigger than anything else that happened. Must just leaned himself in. Just for a moment. And did it without the Shadow Blade because he used it after. Well, they found him. Back to Invis. The Dive Pack does enough damage to get the kill. He didn't know where exactly. Actually, he knew where he had him because the leash had dragged him out that direction. So he knew exactly where he had to put the Dark Pack damage. Is under attack. So next thing maybe Nature's Prophet needs is, some treads. Some strength treads. Something to give him some extra life points when that kind of stuff happens again. So, Timbersaw. 9 Bloodstone charges for him, looking nice. Okamajai actually gets a hand of Midas. You don't see this often, but a lot of ogres also need to find a way to get themselves up high points up in the multicast. And sometimes that's the only way to do it. Have they got dust? They got a sentry ward. Pounce up, he's been put up, he's still got leap available. Trying to get further away before he did it though. He wasn't held in position.
Pull roots and run!
How's that bottom lane? The T1 tower's looking still quite healthy. But Tri-Tartar's gonna attack directly into
Dire's
it anyway.
Bottom tower is under attack.
He might be able to force the fortification out. He at least is forcing out the TPs. You know, he's got Shadow Blades, so we can bail out of here very quickly. And that's the power of the Shadow Blade on a Prophet. You know, you can just push the envelope a little bit further than you normally would because you have that escape mechanism. On the bright side too, in the later portions of the game, when your damage output starts getting higher, you're able to be the initiator. Probably more importantly, you're actually able to get that burst damage at the very, very start. But that's the downside about the Shadow Blade, which doesn't make it as powerful anymore than Nature's Prophet. While he'd love to be the initiator, he isn't able to just, like, cut out the fight long enough to have the Shadow Blade come back off cooldown again, and then use it to escape. That's what made the Nature's Prophet so damn good with the old Shadow Blade. You had the time to actually attack and escape because of the cooldown duration. Now pressure on the bottom lane, Exorcism level 2. So they're ready to push again. And the split push isn't fast enough here from Moscow 5 to really cause them any kind of problems. I think M5 also realized this. They can't defend their tier 2 tower right now. They do as much damage to the tier 2 tower in the mid. Fortification will delay them up a little bit. But there's fortification also available here for Aftershock. But they'll melt through most of the creep wave to start with. Timbersaw with the Chakram. Cleans up a lot of them, but now, first time. The Eclipse could actually hurt pretty heavily here. Radiant's bottom tower is just going to be a loosened beam that's stolen by the Rubick. Not really a mana pool to contest at the moment. Their bottom tower is still not down yet. And now in comes Tra-Ta-Ta. In behind him. He just has the Sprout so he can hold him there long enough for the follow-up movement. The Yule Scepter up in towards the air, and now they've got the Lee Show from the Oak Magi with the Eclipse with the damage from Blow Your Brain. They can't see him, but the Sprout actually keeps him far enough away from Oak Magi. He's going to back up and then turn for the stun. The arrow too early. There will be the follow-up multicast done with the Sprout. They get the vision in the tree line. The tier 2 tower will drop for that. Prophet. Rubick there who can actually solo kill you. Even with Shadow Blade. You're going to need Wrath of Nature to get this kill. Oh, maybe? Yeah, with the Lucid Beam as well as Fey Bolt. Takes away the damage. Okay, it took a while before he did that. Maybe I was wrong. Damage output's enough from Prophet. Triggers the Midas. Shadow Blade, and now this is that. Okay, yes, has a Moonlight Shadow to help him. Check it. He got caught up in the Timbersaw. Well, the Moonlight Shadow gets wasted from Moscow 5. And there's a Rubick for a Prophet as the trade-off. But solo experience and gold coming in for the Timbersaw. Not to mention an extra Bloodstone charge. 3,000 gold net worth now, advantage from Moscow 5 and the gold. Definitely looking a lot better for them. But Aftershock won't give up. They have an SMY over on this Slark and a Raid to fight.
I'll take that.
He's not going to find an opening here. Just pinging out the fact that he must be watched. Losing his Shadow Dance as he runs through the Radiant Jungle. Full BKB now purchased up by the Luna. So only the physical damage will harm her now. And speaking of physical damage, most of it is actually magical being applied. Chain up, PGG, no leap, evades the Chakram into the corners, but there's a blink taken now over on the Timbersaw. And impossible to evade. Up at the top rune. Okay, a lot of ignites being thrown out. No Ravage available, and well, you won't see Tron getting into the tree line in time. As the rest of Aftershock just fall over each other for a moment. Trying to get through that narrow choke point. Coming straight towards that middle lane with the Yule Scepter set up. They leave an aggressive Observer Ward behind, more than likely. Yep. And an Exorcism will allow them to push into this tier 2 tower. And they'll see everything coming at them. Death Prophet's also starting up into a BKB. Oka Magi. Just starts the Ignite, no multicast on it. And then Slark pounces straight away. They need an extra stun to come up, but he's silenced for the moment, and they just chain him to death. Wrath of Nature does a lot of work here on the Rubick, who continues to tank up the tower. The tower will go down as Blow Your Brain. He's still got this BKB available, and now he'll trigger, but he's already so low in life, he cannot stay on the front lines.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
How long is it going to take before they buy a gem? They can't wait much longer. There's too many of these kills which Nature's Prophet's just slipping away from. And the Moonlight Shadow allows the entire Moscow 5 to slip away from them. The Observer Ward scouting out the Timbersaw. They'll also see the Abaddon coming up. Moonlight Shadow, but they drop the Sentry Ward. Which means they get rid of the ults pretty quickly. The Timbersaw, not the easiest one to kill, especially when he has that Blink Dagger. Oh, Abaddon. Walk into it. This guy wants to play in the outfield. Because he caught it! So now 16-17 on the board. Again, we're seeing another solo attempt at a kill. Over on Mind Control. Silence on the Prophet, but that doesn't stop him from using his Shadow Blade. Okay, they've got to get a gem over on that Slark. I know it's kind of like the... not really exactly what you want to do. But Slark's primary thing is meant to make Nature's Prophet worry about him being on the map. Everywhere, anytime, any place, any... And then again, he also needs disabled, doesn't he? But he can still buy into something like a Basher. That'll work. Just one of the supports buys the gem for him. I got a Desolator over on Nature's Prophet coming to the bottom lane. No. You are not fighting that Timbersaw, man. No matter how strong you think you are, you're not fighting that Timbersaw. His primary goal is to find everybody else. And then again, he also has to control these lanes. So the Timbersaw just runs himself away. And the ping's coming out, just scouting at the fact that he is there. And the T1 tower in the bottom lane. Oh, not a lot of life points left on it. So it wouldn't take it long for a Nature's Prophet with the Desolator Shadowblade to bring down. He's almost dishing out 200 damage pop plus the negative armor effect. As Boy Your Brain goes back to his farming. Mana Style's not far off. So, Basher for Slark. So he's the first one who actually finds some level of extra control. This is always required from Aftershock, primarily because their lineup just doesn't have that much control in it. Aftershock need that tier. Like, then again, did they go for the tier 2 tower? No, they just waited for Roshan. Who is up now? So, second Roshan available. They get rid of the Observer Wards to start with. Someone with a 4-star that can bring him down. Nope, he just pounces. And they actually group up like they're thinking about going for Roshan. But on top lane, currently got a Timbersaw on a bit of a run. Well, your brain's keeping that pressure up quite nicely. In fact, they may have enough. They're going to Sprout in the tree line, reveal him off. One more Lucid Beam, but the Sprout's keeping him away from the Timbersaw, who just changed himself Dyer's deeper. Top tower is under Roshan attack. Has been started. The Death Prophet ulti has been used. And with the Moonlight Shadow, the arrow will fly in. It'll give them all the vision they want to. It's a good stun on the Death Prophet, but now they turn around. They pick him up. They throw him back. The arrow is being returned, in fact. But Roshan belongs to them. The Slark is the man with the Aegis Immortal on his tail. No Yule Scepter, so they can't cancel the TP out from the Tidehunter. Doesn't stop the Mirana from going down. Bash. Oh, he got one. And the Okamishai will take a fall. The Tier 2 tower did die in the top lane in the meantime. So what do we got now? There's that gem finally being purchased. It's taken a little bit too long, but it's been done. So it's not being purchased up by the supports. It's being carried by the supports. But it was purchased by the Timbersaw. You kind of need to have his BKB up. This might kind of bite him in the ass a little bit later on, but then again, if they can get pickoffs like this, then hell no, it won't. 55 seconds on the sideline. Your Death Prophet ulti, 60 seconds away. They can still force the Tier 2 tower, but then again, you've got Nature's Prophet already up on this top lane, making sure that Aftershock have to look behind them at all times. Really, this game is quite even. The split push power could just be too strong from Moscow Fire for Aftershock to deal with, but Aftershock's direct fight power right now is a lot better. Until these bigger items start getting over on Luna. At which point, then it becomes questionable. You got a Manta and BKB, which isn't too shabby. Whoop, there goes your Mirana. PGG getting picked off. There's these arrows coming out from the Rubick. Unable to find their target just yet. Leaves the Observer Ward behind, then blinks himself away from the Ogre Magi. Both teams now should know there's obs up there. Especially the Timbersaw. Well, then again, it's the Rubick who's the man walking around with a gem. Or was. Wait, it's on the Abaddon now. It's on the Abaddon. With his level 2 ulti, it's difficult to kill him, but unfortunately, he can't reach up on high places. He has to call for a teammate to come over and get the deny on the ward. Oh, there she goes. So, 3 seconds till Mirana's up, but you got Death Prophet ulti available. And you've already got Sly Conditioning. Blow your brain triggers. BKB needs the attack, and the Ravage will buy him the space to do so. With the Eclipse, let the Glaze bounce. Blow your brain. Let the Glaze bounce. He needs to keep attacking. Now the Sprout controlling the Abaddon. He's still the oldie from the Death Prophet. And the Slark will blink himself away. So Ravage is down. Wrath of Nature was used during that too. And the Eclipse. All blown. And Aftershock, they lost Aegis. And that was off. And instead of Timpasaur retreat, he's got these BTs so he can come and join them again. But it'll be another 25 seconds before he can do it. And they can't need to wait the extra 2 minutes out anyway for the Death Prophet ultimate. About to do some de-warding. Blow your brain. Blink down. They got the pickup. Then a blink into a leash. He doesn't have a BKB charge, so he can't protect himself. A Lucent Beam. Rubick knows it could almost kill him off, but then he's just sticking around. He actually gets himself a fresh Lucent Beam again for the Prophet. TP'd in into the Shadow Blade. Looking to hide, but the gem's over on the Slark, so there's nowhere to hide here. And the extra TP's coming in from the Timbersaw. So they'll chop down the tree line to make sure there is not even a crevice he can hide. Under attack. Oh, don't die yet. And that'll give Timbersaur his BKB. Almirana wants to battle up against the Death Prophet. He did some nice damage into that Death Prophet. And with some help from a hero like Nate's Prophet, that'll work too. But he bought back to try and become part of this. But there's still that BKB over from Death Prophet. The arrow will fly, but it's way too far behind. Don't have any chance of hitting Death Prophet. Ogamish Giant. This Midas really hasn't done much at all. Next Prophet, Shadowblade, 4 seconds. Look at the cooldown timer on that thing. Yul Scepter, yep. Sends him up. We'll Crib Swarm him out. He'll go in, Viz. The Timbersaw will come in, but yeah, they don't have any vision of him. The Slark is still on the other side of the map. Sitting in middle lane, waiting for the Prophet to make his play here. And then he'll pounce. Full Ravage, double Ravage now up for the Tidehunter. So one of those things could easily turn a fight. With no BKB being built up by Slark. Of course you do have the BKB coming up on the Timbersaw. There'll be a full BKB too, but then again... No. He's switching it. Switching into Aghanim Scepter. Ravage being used right now over on the Slark. Is he going to get the Refresher ulti off again? Right now, potential is there. He's already used it. There goes your second Ravage. But the damage has been done. The Tide's gone down. Ravage stolen by the Rubick. He's perfectly back in again. There's two for the price of two. But it won't remain that way because they've found Tratata outside the base. And he will take a fall. And this means they can breach high ground. The arrow's coming in again. All dodged. PGG has really had a very unlucky Mirana. Or just a skillful Aftershock lineup. Yeah, it was the Aghanim Scepter is what he put his BKB on hold for. So he can get the double Chakram. But they want to work through this mid-rags, then they just wait it out again, wait for the next Roshan, and push in through the bottom. Arrow comes. 5 seconds done over on the Death Prophet. The Ignite only connects on the creep wave. But they want this range rags down as well. The full ragsing is really what they require. Radiant's middle barracks are under attack. That's what gives them momentum to bring down those tier 4 towers. Now they can back the hell out of there. Radiant's middle barracks has fallen. And they should just rotate towards the bottom. Roshan's still got another 2 minutes before he can potentially spawn. So they're going to come up towards the top, or at least one of them is. It's because the tier 2 tower is still up here. The Dire Observer Ward will watch any kind of movement from the Radiant side. Now they're going to group up, smoke and go. Probably going to push it a little bit further first. Full Skadi now over on the Slark. So SMY Basher didn't go the full Abyssal, just wanted the chance to get the interruption on TPs. But having the Skadi makes it so much easier to chase down heroes. Not to mention his stats are really freaking good now. 2.5k life points on the Slark who's able to regenerate at whim. If only if you can just get out of vision of the enemy. They're about to have another crack up here on Tratatar again. Slark being involved means there's nowhere to hide. The Abaddon will be connected on, will connect to PGG's arrow. But he already had the shield up, so the damage output was minimal and there's no follow-up. They're moving so quick. Blink, pounce. The leaps are being used by Mirana. She's got an ultimate available as well. But instead, the chases are happening on multiple sides. Blow your brain. A BKB TP-out's the only thing that was going to save him, but now they know his BKB is also on cooldown. With an exorcism up, that's a ticket to push bottom lane. It's the other reason, too, why I didn't think they'd go towards the top lane, because without the tier 2 tower on the bottom lane, they got easy access just to go directly into the tier 3 and look for a secondary Raxing. And that's the goal right now, or should be the goal right now. With the regeneration rune, Death Prophet just needs to keep herself back. And just keep spamming abilities, lose a little bit of life points, just bail yourself out. Ward's getting dewatered, chained down, and there goes your ulti. Fortification not available. So I burn through it pretty quickly. Good arrow, but then quick pounce. The Ravage will connect here from Tron, but again, he's given the Ravage over to the Rubick. He's waiting at the BKBs. Actually, yeah, these are waiting for Blow Your Brains, but Blow Your Brains doesn't have a BKB. He can blink himself in. There's your Ravage. The Eclipse